I'm very pleased to be here and to be invited also last year to Istanbul, where our project received the Europa Nostra Award in the fourth category, Education Awareness Raising. And I did that in behalf of my colleagues, the social workers, the craftsmen, who aren't able to come here altogether. And I think it's important to mention them in that moment. I will talk to you about now about the architect and the history of this Bathhaus you mentioned already, about the idea behind our project. I will show you some of our results and give you some ideas about the future and some of our experiences we have done. First of all, I'll talk about Ludwig Hoffmann. He was the director of the Municipal Building Department of Berlin between 1898 till 1925, and he influenced very much building activities in, these, in this time. He was an architect, actually, and he built very important buildings like the extension of the town hall in these times, or also very famous museums. Here you see the Museum Island, which is World Heritage as well. And, this one. This is the Pergamon Museum, which he continued from his colleague, Alfred Messel. But he was director of the building department in a time where Berlin was very much growing, and people lived in these buildings with up to 8 courtyards, and the need of public and social infrastructure was very urgent. Therefore, he was building hospitals and schools, and as well public bathhouses, swimming pools. He built 4 of them, and the only one left is actually the Berwald Bad. 2 other ones were destroyed in the Second World War, and the second one is still existing, but it doesn't work for 20 years already. So, and these buildings, these bathhouses were actually not built that people learn to swim, but they were built that people can take a shower and can take a tub. So therefore we come to the history of the baths now. Here you have these structures which are not existing anymore. These are little cabins, cubicles, where you had the chance to get a shower. And you had many of them in these 2 complexes, also in this one where they don't exist anymore. You see 2 parts of the building. This one, from built from 1898 till 1901. And this building is still existing here. You have the facade in an old photograph from 1901. And here you see the old swimming pool itself, which still exists. It's a contemporary photograph. And you have a second part, which is the newer part. It was built in from 1915 to 1917 due to the pressure of these public swimming pools. So but this building was destroyed in the Second World War, just 30 years after it was opened to the public. And after the war, the district municipality, the neighborhood municipality, they rebuilt the building in the style of 1917. From the outside, you can see the old facade. It's the same as 1917. But in the inside, and you could maybe see it on the floor plan, they implemented a complete new hall in the style of the 1950s. So let's come to our idea. And to of the building side school. To understand the idea, you must know something about the institution of history of that building. It was actually managed, all these swimming pools were managed by the district municipalities until 1996. And then they were outsourced into a corporation under public law. And a few years later, 13 swimming pools in Berlin were closed. And among these 13, one was also the Bärbelsbad. But all the little districts had the chance to reopen them, but only one district has done that, and it has done that in association with a sports association, which is a legal body actually, swimming association. So, and this legal, this sports association is doing that for now 9 years already, more or less through voluntary work. And after the takeover of this TSB, which is the swimming association, new ways of partnerships had to be found in for different tasks. And one of these tasks was also the field of regulation. So that's why one idea was the building side school. And now I think the aspect of luck comes into play, which Professor Scholler mentioned before yesterday. This time the local job center, the agency looking for the unemployed, was searching for a public building where the young people could work on, where they can be trained on, or they can get back into work. And at Bärbelsbad, a lot of work had to be done. And I think this is also important, and it belongs to this point of luck. TSB was ready actually to agree to this step-by-step process due to the lack of money. Maybe he would have liked it much more to get an amount of money and to renovate the whole building, but it wasn't possible. Therefore, the TSB accepted that. And then there was Zukunftsbau, which I will present now. It's a company organizing the whole process of renovation. And Zukunftsbau is actually a company dealing with young people and vocational training for 20 years now. We started with squatted buildings, actually, and went into these buildings and educated the young people, renovated the house with the young people. And afterwards, the house was renovated, the young people had a proper profession, and so therefore, it was, I think, a good partner to do that. So I mentioned a few of the partners, the job center, the municipality itself, the List GmbH, which is actually an urban regeneration company, the Zukunftsbau, I mentioned the TSB, and beside of that, some European funding programs helped a lot. Some program from the European Social Fund or the European Fund of Regional Development. So our target group are disadvantaged young people between the age of 16 and 25. Some are older sometimes. They have no qualifications, more or less, or work experience, and many of them didn't complete really school properly. And since this Bärbelsbad is in an inner city district with a lot of migrant population, many of them have a migration background, and living in an area of urban rehabilitation. So the main objectives of our project, we want to actually socially integrate these young people. We want to give them a chance to get a job, to get orientated in the market of professions and all that in the field of building activities and professions. And of course, also, one of the main objectives is the restoration of parts of the building. So, I put that at the third point because our main objectives are the people and not the building, to put it clearly here. And also, of course, our efforts to do that also help that the bus really keeps being a bus. And for the youngsters, we try to get some intercultural activities to them. So what have we done? You have seen the on the floor, you have seen these little cubicles and cabins. And when we arrived there in 2007, they were all demolished already. And so we found unusable spaces and rooms. And therefore, we tried to refurbish them, to renovate them. And we installed a kind of workshop for the painters and lacquerers. And here in these cubicles, the youngsters can learn different techniques. You can see some of these different painting techniques here downstairs. They can try it here in these cubicles and then it get whitewashed together. And of course, this makes the project maybe special. The second pillar on that curriculum is the practical work on the bus. So we try to figure out some renovation works, and then they can learn their profession just on a living example. And I did mention actually the young people are not only in the cubicles and not only working in practical work in the bus, but they are also in a school where they get the theoretical background. But this happens also on the bus actually. What we do is still do some projects, some thematic workshops and so on. You can see here diversity training among the young people. And we also try to get them an intercultural horizon by getting them out of the district, which is very important because many of them, they really hesitate to leave their neighborhood. And it was very interesting to travel with them to Istanbul to show them many of them came have a Turkish origin to travel to Turkey with them and to see them behave there in this surrounding. We try once a year to put not all of them, but some of our young people into international projects. In Istanbul, we have renovated a facade here in Büyükada, with these young guys here, carpenters from Germany. And just now, in 1 week, a group of people will go to Italy and renovate there in a medieval palace. So let me share some of our results. We found this staircase, this stair house actually here before restoration. We had a lot of scaffolding and all that in the house. To say that it was always done when the bus is running, so on the full bus operation. So after that, we discovered actually the oak stairs, and we found some old paintings here. So we tried to show them again. In the entrance hall, there weren't any doors anymore. They were left, I don't know when it happened. And the whole bus was painted in a very nice gray and dark gray and light gray. So, and we figured out the original paintings together also with the Department of Conservation of the of Berlin. And so afterwards, we created the doors again and painted the frames of the doors in the original green color. One of the big steps was the main hall itself. So you can see here these plastic cubicles, actually changing cubicles in the main hall. And we tried to really reconstruct the old doors by hooks. But what we didn't achieve in the first step was were these sculptures, these wooden sculptures. And it really, yeah, I really wanted to have them. So I tried I wrote letters to all the wood carving schools in Germany, Switzerland, and Austria. And finally, we didn't succeed in finding one school in the south of Germany, what I expected, I would have expected. But we ended up in Flensburg, which is on the Danish border. And they got these photographs of the originals, which were quite well photographed in the time when the house was built. And in a 3 months' time, they came with these 10 sculptures, and they have done that in the vocational training, becoming a wood carver. So it was a great thing, I think, for the bus, because now the hall became got the same the old shape. Here you see it more in detail. One of the more recent projects is the renovation of these walls in the 1950 part of the building. Here also a lot of scaffolding and all that. And we discovered, you can see it maybe a bit light blue on the ceiling. And finally we receive that yellow and blue painting. So I think it's regaining also kind of the beauty of the architecture of the 1950s, which was not seen anymore because of this gray color. Another big thing was also here, the reuse of the shower cubicle rooms. Actually, as I said, they didn't exist anymore when we came there, but we found these rooms like that, and a lot of work had to be done, a lot of rubble had to be taken out, and now it looks like that, and now it's, of course, there wasn't anything heritage-like, so it's a modern room now, and the room was light, and it's used now as a gym for many rooms. But there's a second floor as well, so we're just doing that now. But it's not only this thing in the bus itself. We are trying to go out with our work. So we are in street festivals sometimes, so we try to create some enthusiasm among children for this profession of painting and lacquering. So a master or professional actually, he comes with his apprentices to the street festivals, and so we try to show these techniques. We have different exhibitions here in a very busy market. You can see it's upstairs, but we try to show it that everybody can see that and attracts people to go there. And some of printed results you can see outside on the tables. And we use, of course, this beautiful hall for events. And I remember last November this Europa Nostra ceremony, which was, I think, a very remarkable event because it took place in this swimming pool and all the people had to wear the plastic hats. So, there are more projects in the past, small ones, but not so important ones. Therefore, I would like to come to the future. We have to do much more, and as I mentioned, the framework is not so easy. We have to wait also for money, some legal problems, and therefore, we didn't actually succeed in renovating the ceiling of this hall, which falls down. But before that, the roof itself needs reparation of the facades and also. So it's a big project actually, which has to be done in the next years. And part of this future discussion is also that it has to be said that the premise can be used as location for sports and swimming as well. And there's some legal fighting and so on. But I think these prices, this being here in Dubrovnik, being honored, I think it plays a role in this process, and therefore I'm very thankful for these prices. So the project combines conservation, vocational training, and education when it comes to an end. Includes various partners, not normally dealing with heritage. We try to concentrate also on public relations, and I think the project is bypassing budgetary constraints and creates a win-win situation for all the participants. The challenges: we have limited financial resources, and we deal not with a municipal body, but with a voluntary working association, which makes it's a different culture of communication. Really makes sometimes things very difficult. There is this already mentioned political and legal uncertainty about the future of the baths, and sometimes some resistance of the Chamber of Commerce. They want, but companies get the work and not such a strange project as we are. And we have to construct under full operation of a bath, as I mentioned. And so we have to deal with apprentices, with personal difficulties, with lack of accountability and efficiency, and they have their schedule for vocational training. To come to an end, it seems to be very simple and convincing, but it's not easy transferable, I would say, at least in the German framework. But it shows also that good quality is possible with these young people and awareness raising of heritage can be achieved. So I think Bellotbad is a process, it's not a finished project. Thank you.